हेलो एवरीबॉडी, गुड आफ्टरनून। ओके सो आई पोस्टेड थ्री लेक्चर्स। सो फर्स्ट यू टेल हाउ द लेक्चर्स गोइंग ऑन। इज इट ओके? डिड यू कुड अंडरस्टैंड थिंग्स और यू हैव एनी कंफ्यूजन, एनी क्वेश्चंस? जस्ट लेट मी नो। एनी क्वेश्चंस ऑन द लेक्चर्स?
सर, आई हैड अ डाउट इन द फर्स्ट लेक्चर.
या ओके।
सो व्हेन वी डिराइव द रिलेशन फॉर द फ्रीक्वेंसी इन द केस ऑफ ग्रेविटी बीइंग एब्सेंट, वी फाउंड द फॉर्मूला 1/2 पाई रूट के बाय एम. एंड व्हेन वी सॉ द ग्रेविटी इन प्रेजेंट कंडीशन, देन वी रोट द के बाय एम एज जी बाय डेल्टा, एंड द फ्रीक्वेंसी फॉर्मूला बिकेम 1/2 पाई रूट जी बाय डेल्टा. सो इन दिस केस, आई मीन, इफ वी से दैट here g by delta can be it can be said that if the gravity is absent here, g will be equal to 0, delta will be equal to 0, which will give us a 0/0 form. So this 0/0 form should actually be indeterminate, but in an harmonic motion the frequency should not be indeterminate. Why is it coming so?
Okay, so see here, the vibration is independent of gravity. Gravity does not play any role, first of all. Okay, when you say g over delta, this is only to replace m over k or k over m. Okay, got it?
Yes.
So basically the basic equation here is omega n equal to root k over m. However, this is a basic. It does not depend on g. If you take a spring mass system to moon, for example, same spring mass system, you take it to moon or Jupiter or anywhere, frequency remains the same. Got it?
Yes.
G is not involved. G we are having there just to relate to the displacement, you know. So actually we are finding out the ratio of k over m as ratio of acceleration due to gravity and displacement. You got it?
Yes.
So this is not a primary equation. So g over delta is not a primary equation. This is derived basically. Got it?
Yes.
So we don't have to even study g over delta. That's only for, you know, reference. So we got g over delta because we got what the k from the displacement. We found out what the k is, right?
Yes.
From displacement and from mass, we got the what the k is, and because of that, we are getting that g over delta. Okay,
Yes.
so got it?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Any other question? So could you follow the lectures? Lecture clear? No answer. Did you see the lectures, guys? Okay, this is supposed to be interactive session. Okay, so please talk, you know. So otherwise I will not know what your problems are. Okay, so I have posted three lectures, and today again I will post one more lecture. So that will conclude the chapter 2. Okay, I have also posted the tutorial problems. So please solve them. We will also solve here. Also, I will post a homework for the continuous assessment I was talking about. So you will get a few days to complete this homework. Okay, and that will be based on the Moodle. Okay, so that we are going to do. So today's lecture that I will post will complete chapter number 2, and tutorial we will start today itself. Okay. Okay. Any questions on any concepts that we talked about? If not, then I will start the tutorial. Any doubt you can ask. Okay, if not, then let me share the screen. Sorry guys. Okay, so we will start with tutorial problems and each problem. So I have already posted the tutorial problems. Okay, so we will let's solve a few of them. So remember that the chapter is not completed yet. So we are going to have one more lecture today on that chapter, chapter number 2. So only those things which are covered till now, I will only solve those questions. So first question is 2.5. Okay. So question 2.5 that tells that we have this kind of situation. We have one spring which is hanging from a ceiling, and then we have a mass which is something like this one. The mass is M2, and which is above another mass of M1, and the height is around is h. And then what is the question? The question is if mass, this mass, if it drops through height h, this one, and sticks to m1, so this comes here and sticks to m1 without any rebound, they determine the subsequent motion. After that, what is the motion is that it is telling. Okay, so how will we found out? Okay, so here are again, this kind of problem you must have actually solved during your JE days, right? So what you have to find out is the energy, right? Total energy has to be conserved. So the potential energy, which is going to convert it into kinetic energy, right? So first, when this drops down by h, so we have potential energy P total, which will be converted into kinetic energy, will be mgh. So here m2, g, and h. And that will be converted into the kinetic energy, right? So then what will happen? You will have kinetic energy is equal to P is equal to m2gh, and where the kinetic energy is also half total mass will be now m1 plus m2, right? And v square, right? Half mv square. So this is the total energy, kinetic energy, and from here we can find out. So from here, half m1 plus m2 v square is equal to m2 gh, and this will give us value of v, right? So v will get equal to root m2 gh divided by here will be 2 and m1 plus m2, right? So v will be equal to root under 2 m2 gh over m1 plus m2. So this is the v, means this is just after this mass drops down and sticks to m1, just after that velocity of the combined mass is this mass. Yeah, then you have to formulate the problem now. So now we note that initial velocity is equal to 2 m2 gh over m1 plus m2. So what we will do, first we will write the equation. Now what is the equation now? So now our system now becomes like this. So we have now k, and then this complete mass will be m plus m2. This is now total mass. And then what is the equation? The equation will be, so this we can say equal to m, small m, and you know that equation of that is equal to mx double dot plus kx is equal to zero. So this is the equation. Yeah. So this is the equation. We are talking about just after impact of the first mass to the second, just after that velocity increases, you know, from rest there will be a certain velocity, and from there we are counting now. So our time starts from then, and right then the equation is this one, and equation is not sufficient. As you know, there has to be some initial conditions, and what is the initial condition? So this you have to also write the initial condition. So initial condition, what is that? X zero is equal to zero is one condition, and then second is x dot zero is equal to v, right? And what is that v? So x dot zero equal to v is equal to what we found out here. This is the equation, right? So you will have a root. So root 2 m2 over, so what that is, right? M2 gh, m2 gh divided by m1 plus m2. So this is x2 dot. Yeah. Okay, so now you have this equation to solve now, right? So you have this equation to solve, and you can do that. So this now becomes a mathematics now. So you have to solve this equation, and you can do it. One of the way, as I like in the lecture video, you can use the Laplace transform to solve it. You know, so we can have this Laplace transform of this. Yeah, so next will be, you have the mx double dot plus kx equal to zero, and then we have Laplace transform applied to that, it then becomes m, and then you have s square x s minus s, and then you have x 0 minus x dot 0, right? Fine. Okay, and then that will be equal to plus k x s equal to 0, and now you have those values here, so you can have xs, which can be in common, then you have kms square plus k, right, which is equal to, you have this thing, and then will be equal to m times s, and x0 is 0. So you know that we apply the boundary condition here. So this value is 0. So we can actually write, because in boundary condition, the initial condition, we have x0 equal to 0. So you can put 0, and this value we also have, right? So we will not write here this one, because this one, this part becomes 0. So, but we have this part now, so we get m times v. So we have m times v, right? That's what we get. So we get m s square plus k multiplied by x capital xs, then m times v, that's we get here. Yeah. And hence we get x s equal to mv over ms square over k. So these, all these things are already there in your lecture. Yeah. And where v, what is v here? Where v is this? V is for us, this is a constant. We found out what the v is. Yeah. And now we can find out the how the behavior of that will be, and how it will be. This will be like you can find out now the inverse transform of that. So xt will be inverse transform of xs, will be inverse transform of mb over ms square plus k. Yeah. And what will you find out? Looking at this one, how does it look like? So we have, does not have s term in the numerator. So this will be totally the sinusoidal function, right? So it will be, you can actually guess how it will look like. So this will be equal to v over, so will be equal to L inverse. And we have v over, you can have m here cancels out, here k over m. So v over s square plus, here we have k over m. Yeah, will be equal to k over m is nothing but we say omega n in that case, right? So omega n. So we will have v, right? We'll have v, and then we have L inverse of 1 over s square plus omega n square. Okay. Then we can write, multiply here omega n, and here we can divide by omega n, and so that we will have v over omega n, and Laplace transform of this is nothing but sine, right? So this becomes sine omega n t. So your x t is given by v divided by omega n sine omega n t. This is the answer, where of course omega n equal to root k over m, where m is equal to, where m equal to m1 plus m2, right? And v is equal to 2m2 gh divided by m1 plus m2. Clear? Any questions here? So you don't have to memorize equations, you know, so you can, that's why you have the derivation in the lectures. You can understand the concept, not that just you memorize. All those things are actually concepts here. Some mathematics, this course you will be relating to mathematics a lot. As whatever you learned, you can see here what is the meaning of that and why that is important. Yeah, any question, guys, in this one? Any confusion you have? Anything you want to understand? Any question for this problem? Yeah, Danish, did you say anything? Any question, guys? No?
Sir, I have a doubt.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
So why didn't we include the gravity in this equation? As we had included it in the energy one, but we didn't include in this equation.
Okay. Okay, we will not include gravity anywhere. Why? Because vibration is property of just mass and stiffness, spring, that's it. Whether you take it on, what is the difference? Let me look at that. There was another question earlier also about the gravity and all. Gravity and those things, here we discuss in the lecture or in your book you have, just to, you know, demystify things, like just to make it clear that what is the role of the gravity. Now, take example, like we will take example like a space, let's take in the on the Earth, what happens? We will take three examples, right? So we have the same spring mass system and which is in a space. I write it a space, okay? So let it be a space here. And we have one spring and one mass, right? Say K and this is M. And let's look at now Earth. Same system if we have here. Now, because of gravity, what happens is there will be a certain displacement, right? So it will be a stretch because of displacement. Yeah, and it will be something like this one. So what happens? There will be, I'm exaggerating here. So there will be displacement delta in that case. Right? So let's call it delta 1 for the Earth. Now look at the Moon. Yeah, so same system. If we take to the Moon, there will be some displacement. Yeah, there will be some displacement, and let's say this one is delta 2. Now you see what is happening here. Only the initial configuration is different in all the three cases. But if I give a small push here, you know, then the frequency will be same here as here. If you give a small push here, this will also vibrate in the same omega. So what happens here also, we have omega n is equal to k over m. Here also we will have omega n equal to k over m. Here also we have omega n equal to k over m. We don't care what the displacement is. It will not affect. Only thing is, visually it is different. Meaning that what you see is a displacement here, and this will vibrate about this displacement. You know, so let's say if it is vibrate, you give the same displacement. Let's say you give the same displacement and release it. This one, you are giving same displacement, releasing it. It will go from here to here. This will go from here to here. This will go from here to here. Same displacement in both the cases. But in one case, this will be, in the all the cases, it will be about the mean position, of course. Even the amplitude will be the same in all cases. The gravity has no role at all. But we, in the equation, we wrote G over delta. Why? Because just to relate it, how? Just see here, let's write it. Yeah, delta 1, what is the delta 1 in this case? Delta 1 will be equal to simply M times G, this is the force, divided by K, right? Divided by K. So if I want to find out K over M, what is the value? So K over M will be equal to g over delta 1. Similarly here, k over m will be equal to g over delta 2. You see, here we have this g over delta 1 only because I want k over m. Since k over m is needed, hence we found out some other method. Just looking at it, we say, okay, from the this distance, if we have in the space, and if you compare with the space in on the earth, we have delta 1, so we can measure delta 1, you know, and we know the gravity, so k over m we can find out. It is like a practical way of finding out k over m rather than, you know, measuring it, rather than going and weighing the mass or using some kind of instrument to find out what the value of k is. You know, so we are just observing and we are telling that, oh, if the displacement is delta, then k over m must be this. Got it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Say any further question, guys? So remember the displacement for this one will be from here to here. Displacement from this one, this one will be from here to here. Same displacement from here to here. So in all cases, what we get the same value. So from here to here, if it's a naught, in all cases, this will be a naught. So remember that. So that's why we ignore gravity. You know, there is no use basically. Yeah. And in your lecture you have like why we don't need basically. Okay. Any other question, guys? Any question you can ask? It could be a silly question. Don't worry. Okay. That's why I am here. So any these things are important. Unless these things are clarified, it will be very difficult later on. So that's why. Okay, guys. Then let's move on to question the second one, and this question is question number 224. So let me see what 224 is. Okay, so question is like this. There is a setup which is given like this. So you have a mass M here and then a spring. Like this. Okay, then you have here. This is X written like this. Then you have a bar which is have a support here, value here is from here to here is B, from here to here it's A, another bar we have, and from that there is a spring which is connected. This is K2, this one is K. And that is all. And what is the, this is point N here given, point N. What is asking? It is asking effective mass, M effective at point N. At point N is equal to what? For the system and its natural frequency. And its natural frequency. Okay. So, and omega n, what is the omega n? Okay. So how to find out? So first we have to set up the equation in this scenario. First thing is to how to find out the equation. Yeah. And how will you do it? Okay. So, first of all, if you have to find out the effective mass at point N, then how will you do it? Okay, now we had something there in the lecture also. So if you have to find out effective mass, we have to find out what is the kinetic energy, right? So one of the method is to find out like if T is the kinetic energy, then T is given by half M effective multiplied by X. So whichever point we are talking about, let's say we are talking about the point about B, we have to find out, right? And where y dot is the velocity of point of interest. Yeah, okay. So y dot is the velocity of point of interest. In this case, we are talking about n. So for the whole system, we have to find out the velocity. Yeah. And not velocity, but the kinetic energy. And then we have to, accordingly, we have to find out that. So how do you find out? Okay. Now looking at C, X here, right? This is a total kinetic energy at any point will be simply given by T of the system will be half M X dot square. Of course, if we were asked what is the effective mass for this point, then effective mass for this point is M, because the kinetic energy is given by half mx dot square. However, we are being asked what is the effective mass at this point. Then what was the problem? Problem is we have to express this term here in terms of the displacement of this point. So first we have to relate how the velocity of this is related to velocity of that. And then we can put that relationship here and we can find out about that. Yeah. So how to find out? So we have to look at like how this displacement here and displacement here is related. So it's very easy. What we have, a system is something like this one. We have a lever, something like this here. And we have A here, and we have a B here, and we know that if you displace it, so let's displace here. If you displace it by from here to here, if it's A, sorry, here to here, if Y, then displacement from here to here, so from here to here is Y, this displacement here to here will be equal to what? Will be simply, since this is A, this is B, simply we will get this one, or is X, will be equal to B over A times Y. Yeah, so we know that this comes from the similar triangle, right? So since this triangle is similar, so everything should be in proportional. So this is B to A, or hence this will be, this to this should be equal to B over A, or B to A, and hence the value X over Y should be equal to B over A, and hence X equal to B over A times Y. So we got the relationship, okay, and hence if we find this one, now next thing is very easy. Now T we are saying is equal to half M effective times X dot square, and is equal to half, well, it's not M effective, sorry. So this is just M, we had T equal to half m, see here, t is half m x dot squared. Yeah, so we have half m x dot squared is equal to half m x dot is nothing but b over a y dot square, right, is equal to half m b square over a square y dot square. Got it? Yeah, and is equal to half m effective multiplied by y dot square. Now, when we are talking about y is the velocity, y dot is the velocity of n about which we have to find out m effective. Hence, now we can say that m effective, comparing from here to here, from here to here, right? What we get? M effective is equal to m b square over a square, as simple as that. You got that? Yeah. This is how we find out m effective. Now there is a second part. This is okay. So before we go ahead, any questions so far? Any question, guys? Now the next part is, what is omega n? Yeah. Okay. So omega n you can find out two ways. One is energy method, and the other is by the force method, right? So in one case you are applying the Newton's law, the other case you are applying the energy law, right? And we can apply, like you have seen. So let's look at the energy method. Yeah. So how energy method will look like in this case? So we have the mass m is like this one. Then we have a spring k, and then we have m here. Yeah, and then we are talking about, this is x in this direction, and then we have like this, and like this one, and then we have a spring which is like this one. I have here, this is a, this is b. We have seen already. Now we also know here that x is related to y, so this is y, this is x. Yeah, so x is also related to y, and we call x equal to b over x over y. X over y is equal to b over a, that we know, or simply x equal to b over a times y. So that we have this equation already. Yeah, and from there we can find out. Yeah, so now we can find out without looking at what the forces are. We can actually derive very easily. And what you have to do, we have to find out total energy, right? So total energy of the system is equal to T plus P, where kinetic energy is half m x dot square, right? And then potential energy is the coming from the springs, right, in this case. Yeah, or this is steam energy, potential energy and steam energy, both are the same in this case. So half m x dot square, that's coming from the kinetic energy, and plus potential energy, we have two springs. So this one is k2, what is the displacement of k2? So plus half k2 y square, half kx square, right? This is the energy of the spring. So half k2 y square for this spring, and for this spring, how much is this? This is x, right? So this will be simply half k x square, right, is equal to zero. Not equal to zero, sorry. This is the total energy, right? And remember that we have to write all of these with respect to only one variable. And what is the, either you write as x or y, but not both, right? So See, this is 1 degree of freedom system only, so it will have just either x or y, right? So so what we're going to do, we will replace this y with y equal to a over. So this only we can write that y is equal to a over b, a over b times x. So y will be equal to a over b times x. Okay. Now we can put it here, is equal to half m x dot square plus half k2 y is equal to a over b x square plus half k x square. So we have that. Now what we have to do? So this is x dot, right? Now what we have to do? This u will not change. As you know, that the total energy, that is kinetic energy plus potential energy, will remain constant. And hence we are going to take a derivative of that. So du over dt is equal to zero. And hence d over dt, and we have the equation of u. So we have half m x dot square plus half, and then we have k2 a square divided by b square. So k2 a square over b square x square plus half k x square. Half k x square is equal to zero, or half m 2 x dot x double dot plus half k 2 a square over b square 2 x x dot plus half k times 2 x x dot is equal to zero. So this is the derivative, or we can find out, see here, 2 and 2 cancels out, yeah, and then what is the common? See, x dot is common in all of them, so we can get rid of that. So let me circle it. So all these things will be canceled out. We have a 2 here, and x dot here, right? So we have 2 here, and x dot here, 2 here, 2 here, x dot here. So assuming x dot not equal to zero, of course x dot will change, so it's not always zero, so that really means that we can get rid of it. And what we get finally is m x double dot. So from here m is there, x double dot, plus we have k2, right? Then a square over b square x, right? So we can write here k2 times a square over b square x multiplied by x plus kx equal to zero. So this is the equation you get. Yeah. So you can write it as m x double dot, and x we can have like this one, or m x double dot plus we have k2 multiplied by a square over b square plus k x equal to zero. So this is the equation you got. Yeah. So next thing is, what is the omega n? And you know that in this case, this is the k. We can write this k. The whole thing is, you can write it as, let's call it k1. Okay, so you can write m x double dot plus k1 x equal to zero, where k1 is equal to k2 a square over b square plus k, right? and hence you get here omega n is equal to root k1 over m, or omega n equal to k1 is what? You have k2 a square plus b square plus k divided by n. So this is the answer. Yeah, so this is your answer. Yeah, so this is how you can find out omega n. Any question, guys? It's all right. Yes or no? No, you don't follow. What happened? So I don't get any answer, you know. So that really I don't know. Actually, you are understanding, not understanding. You need more explanation. You know, so it's very hard to tell. So later on, don't tell me that this was like that. This, you know, so this course is quite intensive. Let me tell you in the beginning itself. It has a vibration as well as control, you know, so the pace will be fast. So you have to go through all the lecture videos in timely manner, otherwise it will be too late. Okay, so you are not responding, maybe you know, you, like some of you may not have gone through the lectures, then it will pile up and it will be difficult later on. Okay, now one thing I want to mention here. Here we have used the energy method. The same thing we can solve by using the Newton's law as well, right? The force method. And how do you do that in that case? Okay, so I'm purposefully going to tell that because that is going to help you. So now Newton's method or a force method, right? And how will it work? So you have to find out two things. You have to find out displacement relation and also the force relation. So let us say, let's draw the deformed configuration, how it looks like. So let's see, from here you have, okay, so this has moved to x, you have m, you have k, and then what happens here is this guy has moved this way, okay, and this has moved this way like this. Yeah, so this one where the support is, and what you get here, is here is another spring and which is connected like this one. So original this was the original position. From here it has moved by y. This is original position. From there this has moved by x now, right? Okay, and you know that this value are given, and what is the value? This is a, this is b, which is given. And from here we have seen that x over y is equal to b over a, that we know. But now things are a little different. What is different? Different is now we have to transfer the force as well, right? So far what we see is displacement. If it's y here, then displacement here is x, and it is the relationship. What about the force? If we have applied some force here and it is balanced, then what happens? Moment has to balance, right? So same thing we can draw with respect to the force now. So let's say this is the one which is like here, and now if you are stretching this spring, so let me write here, this is the k2 is written k2. Okay, now if you are stretching this spring here by this one, then it is going to pull it, right? There will be a force which will try to pull it this way. The value will be k2 times y. So let's write it. So value here will be, let me write like this one, right? So this is the force. Let's call it f1, right? Let's call it f2. there will, this force F2, which will pull the, in this direction, will be equal to simply K2 times Y. Why? Because when you stretch it, this will try to restore, this will try to come back to its original position, and hence K2Y will be applying this way. Now, remember that at the same time, this also has to balance, meaning that the there is nothing here, whatever the force is, same force has to be there because this is in equilibrium, right? This is massless, there is no mass for this one. And if this is the position it is maintaining, then most likely, it has to balance the force, and hence the force here has to balance it, and this will be only when the force here, which is equal to F1, has to balance. Yeah, means moment, it has to balance the moment. That really means what? F2 times A has to equal to F1 times B. Then only it can balance. This is a moment balance, right? This is a moment balance. Yeah, so summation of whole moment has equal to zeros, right? Summation of M about O, let's call it O. O is equal to zero. And hence, this will you find out. Hence, you can find out that F1 will be equal to B over A times F2 is equal to B time, over A, and F2 is nothing but K2Y. So we find out F1, which is acting this way. Now look at the mass now. If you look at the mass, which are forces are acting? Now mass has moved this way, in x direction this way. That means this spring is stretched, and there will be a force acting on the mass in backward direction. So we write here, in backward direction, there is a force which will be Fk times x. Okay, now what about at this point? What is the force acting? That force acting will be F1, but which direction? See, on this bar, the force is in this direction. So on the mass, it has to be the opposite direction, right? So the force here will be in opposite direction. This will be exactly equal to F1, right? But F1, but different direction, right? This is equal to B over A K2Y. Now, once you have the forces, you can solve the problem. And X is direction is this one, remember that. So we can draw now, okay? So we have a mass here, M, displacement X is positive this way. Then you have a force acting, which is equal to K times X. Then there is another force acting here, which is equal to B over A K2, B over A K2Y. So what is that? B over A K2Y. But we also know that Y is equal to, there is some relation. What is relation? Okay, we have Y equal to A over BX, right? A over Y equal to A over, okay, just a minute, guys. So Y equal to, so just a minute, guys. So we have to make sure, no, in both the cases, just a minute, F2, let me check here, F2 times A is equal to F1 times B. So this has to match, but X over Y will be equal to B over A. So that is correct. And hence, from here, we can say that Y equal to A over B times X. Now here, we have B over A K2Y. So B over A K2Y. So let's write here now. Y equal to A over BX. A. Uh, Okay. No, there's something wrong, guys, somewhere. Okay, so let me see. So force times the k2y is the force, sure, multiplied by this one. Let me see this a and okay. So as per the book. So here it is A, here it is B. So what is the force F2? C here. Here we made mistake because this is F2 times. Okay, this. Okay, let me see from here. So we have F2 here. F2 is K2 times Y. So K2 here times Y. So A F2 times A is equal to F1 times B. So far so good. So F1 is equal to C here. That's the problem. F1 will be equal to A over B. Okay, so we made a mistake. That's why we thought there will be something wrong here. So here we should have A over B. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Nice. Nice. So we have A over B, so hence we face problem here. Okay, so A over B, K2Y we should get. Yeah. So similarly here we should get A over B. Yeah. So A over B, K2. No, here it is fine. Sorry, here it will be B over A K2Y. And here like this one. Okay, so we have like this one now. Okay, so so what do we get? We get A over B K2Y. So A over B, we get A over B K2Y. So this is the equation. Okay, now we can proceed. So we also have Y, which is equal to A over B X. So we can replace that to here. And what we get? We get like this one. We have M, and then we have KX, and then we have, we can replace that, we get A square over B square K2. Yeah? Right? At times X, we also get X because of this one. Now, looking at that, since the X is in this direction, we can have the equation, right? So we have, what equation we have? You can see the total force in each direction is equal to mx double dot. That's what the equation is, right? And total force in x direction is what? Is, we can write it here, will be kx minus kx, right? Because our y is, our x is in this direction, hence we have minus here. So minus kx minus a square over b square k2x is equal to mx double dot. Hence, your equation becomes mx double dot plus k plus k2a square over b square x equal to 0. See, we get the same equation that we got earlier. So if you look the other equation earlier, we get the same. See here. We got mx double dot plus k2a square over b square plus kx equal to 0, right? Same equation we get by using other method, mx double dot plus k plus k2a square over b square x equal to 0. Yeah. So you see that same problem you can derive differently. And you should have insight. It's very important that you try same problem, you know, just see whether you can solve by energy method as well and force method as well. This will give you insight also. Okay. Any question, guys? Okay, guys, so I have posted the tutorial problem. Please solve them. I will also post the homework now, okay, so that you can go through it. It's very important. Yeah, and the deadline will maybe will be sometime in the weekend. Okay, so please do that. For that, you have to enroll to the Moodle site. So details I will if you have not, so I don't know whether there has been any page created for this course on Moodle. So first I will get it done in case it is not, and then we can have all the exams there. Okay, so homework, including the homework. Okay, guys, see you next week then. Okay, bye.